Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 8332 in the name of Keith Brown on employment support for veterans and their families. Any member who would wish to speak in the debate should please press the request to speak button, and I call on Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion at around 12 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to open today's debate on employment support for veterans and their families, delighted in particular after having had the opportunity in the last hour or so to meet with a number of members of my old unit, 45 Commando, who came at the request of Graham Day, and to hear from them some of their concerns and questions about the role of the Scottish Government in this area. Members will know that the Scottish Government remains committed to improving support to our veterans and their families, and also, crucially, ensuring that they face no disadvantage as a result of their service, and that Scotland also is their destination of choice after that service. We take a whole-of-government approach to supporting our veterans and armed forces community across a number of different policy areas, such as health, housing, employability and skills, and we're working closely together to improve and refine the support on offer to veterans and their families. And today I welcome the opportunity to lead this debate and provide the Chamber with detail on the work that's been undertaken to support veterans and their families, particularly in relation to their employment and skills. Veterans and their families make a huge contribution to our local communities and to society, including the vital experience and skills that they bring to the workforce. We want to maximise the opportunities for them to do just that, and to also try and address any barriers which prevent them from reaching their potential. And I think people such as Edward Mountain and others will know that in the past, the armed forces, the families of armed forces members have not really been to the forefront of thinking amongst the armed forces community, but they are crucial to the good morale of those that serve in the armed forces. And of course, why should they suffer in terms of the employment prospects because a member of their family, a spouse, usually is a member of the armed forces? I'd like to first mention some of the employability services which benefit our veterans and their families. For our part, we remain committed to working with stakeholders, communities and service users to try and design and deliver an employability system that is person-centred, and it treats people with fairness, dignity and respect. And crucially, in reference to that group I've just mentioned, of the families of armed forces members, acknowledges the experience that they will have. It's really quite disturbing to think in many years recently that we have seen people that are nurses, teachers, potentially doctors, not being properly used or given the proper opportunities. It's a benefit both to Scotland and to them if we can make sure we address that. I will do, yes.
Jamie Green.
Many thanks to the Cabinet Secretary. On that very point about getting families and spouses of serving personnel into work and employment, I totally agree with all of that. But in my last couple of visits to RAF Lossiemouth, the biggest thing they said was the problem was childcare. The real issue that's stopping them getting back into work is not the lack of opportunities in the workplace, but the lack of childcare. And surely that's something that will have to be addressed as a matter of urgency as well.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I think this government has done a great deal in relation to childcare. Of course, there have been some changes announced in the UK budget, which may allow for further changes in terms of childcare provision within Scotland. And of course, the particular point that the member raises in relation to families of armed forces, and this point has been raised with me in the past. So I have an open mind as to what we can do to further improve the current provision, and perhaps we'll see how the UK government's provisions work out in course and what the implications of those are for us here in Scotland. We, as I say, take a whole-of-government approach to this, and that would obviously include childcare. We also have our No One Left Behind approach to transforming our employability support and our devolved employability service, Fair Start Scotland. And we're delivering support that is flexible and easy to navigate, that integrates and aligns with other services, and that is driven by evidence and need. And just to come back, because the member, Jamie Green, has mentioned Lossiemouth, there was a case of two, I think, people from the RAF who were leaving the service who had between them come up with an innovative idea, a product which they wanted to sell into the defence market. And we managed at that stage to, or they stayed in that general area, but too often we have got people who the taxpayer has paid an awful lot of money to educate and to upskill that we're willing to see dispersed to the four winds rather than retain those skills here. I know the member raised that in relation to childcare, but we have to make sure we keep more of those kind of people involved and working in Scotland for the benefit of the Scottish economy. I would also want to mention the fact that our services aim to support those who face the greatest barriers to employment, and that includes those who are experiencing mental health challenges as well as disabilities. We want to support them to gain and sustain fair employment, and on a point that I've raised before, it is not enough to say, even though we have, well, I can't remember in my adult lifetime that we've seen unemployment down at 3.1%, so very low unemployment, but notwithstanding that, too often in the past, members of the armed forces, if they get a job, are deigned to be grateful for a job, but really the job they get should be commensurate with the experience, the abilities and the skills which they've developed over their time in the armed forces. We know that individuals don't access services in isolation, so it's right that we take on the role of joining up these services and essentially hiding the wiring behind those services. So we are continuing to work to strengthen the integration and alignment of services with housing, health, justice and others to create a more joined up and effective system to ensure that everybody in Scotland, I will do, including our veterans, are given the opportunity to prosper and achieve their potential. I give way to Alexander Stewart.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. You acknowledge, Cabinet Secretary, that we need to have a joined-up structure. Now, one of the areas that has been identified is maybe the benefit system, and within your own benefit take-up strategy, that acknowledged that veterans were less likely to access the benefit system that they're entitled to. How is that being managed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I think I would want to mention, because the member's raised it, that there are a shocking number of members of the armed forces that access universal credit. That simply should not be the case. We should be paying members of the armed forces enough that they do not have to access benefits. And I would also point out that the reason that's crucial is because universal credit is often a passport benefit to other benefits. Now, if that's the nature of the problem the member's referring to, I'm certainly willing to have a discussion with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Security to see if there are some barriers that we can tear down. But really, we should not be at the stage of members of the armed forces having to draw down benefits like universal credit. So, as I say, we are trying to make sure that we do that joined-up working on behalf of veterans and their families as much as we can. And we are trying to ensure that we have a holistic wraparound package of support which can be particularly valuable to those leaving the armed forces. So our key worker approach can respond to the need for more intensive health support and advice. And just to say again, if we can just get to the stage where the MOD will pass on in advance of somebody leaving the armed forces their health records to a local GP, it can save so much time and so much grief for people that are leaving the armed forces. If the GP can just be made aware of where the person served, any previous health history, then of course that can nip in the bud any continuing problems. All these factors, though, need to work in tandem effectively for an effective transition, and our No One Left Behind approach holds the importance of this at its core. Military leavers can also access support through our devolved National Employability Service, Fair Start Scotland. That offers 12 to 18 months of tailored, person-centred pre-employment support, along with up to 12 months of in-work support available for individuals and their employers. Support offered includes access to workshops and guidance to utilising the transferable skills that veterans have gained during their service, helping them to identify the strengths and potential for their career routes. And that is crucial, because so often in the past, we have seen people coming out of the armed forces not sufficiently aware of the skills that they have. You know, I've heard stories, we probably all have, of people saying, well, I can run and I can shoot a gun. But there is so much more that people learn in their armed forces. And if they don't understand that, then they cannot pass it on to an employer. I give way to Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the member giving way. Would he not welcome a better transition from the armed forces side in giving veterans who are leaving a better understanding of their skills? You spoke about the GP record handover, which I think is crucial, but there are so many skills that members of the armed forces have and sometimes struggle to identify, and actually are not the armed forces themselves best placed to at least signpost the benefit of those in civilian society afterwards?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would absolutely agree with that point, but we have to work on what powers we have. So what we have done is to develop, and this I'm hopeful will come up during the course of the debate, is an SCQF framework which allows people, a toolkit in fact, which allows both civilian employers to understand what, say, a particular training course involves in the armed forces, and crucially also for the veteran themselves to be able to articulate that in a way that's understood by the civilian employer. But I absolutely agree, the armed forces, whether it's on health, whether it's employability, or whether it's on housing, they should be doing more whilst people are actually serving. And, Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased to confirm today that we have extended Fair Start Scotland provision for a further 12 months, meaning that people can continue to be referred to the support until the 31st of March next year. And during these times of financial uncertainty, and particularly those most vulnerable in society, it's even more important that we ensure that people have access to the services and support they need, and I know they will welcome that announcement. Also, it's true to say that despite most people transitioning successfully, we're all too aware of the challenges that some veterans can face. Sometimes we hear of difficulties in finding suitable and enduring employment, or that their experience and qualifications are not adequately understood and appreciated, and that was part of the burden of my answer to Martin Whitefield's question earlier on. So I'm pleased to say that toolkit, which I mentioned, was launched earlier on this month. The Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework Partnerships, New Military Skills and Qualifications Discovery Tool, quite a mouthful. But I'm very proud to say the Scottish Government has provided funding towards that. And of course, much of that work was carried on by my predecessor, Graham Day, in his time as Veterans Minister. It helps employers and educational institutions understand the range of skills and expertise that those leaving the armed forces have to offer. It's also worth highlighting the timing of the tool's launch could not have been better, because across the country and in many different sectors, skill shortages continue, and many employers are starting to realise there could be a huge untapped resource in terms of service leavers and veterans, and that diverse group with a wide range of skills can help address some of these shortages. And the tool can help both them and employers understand the contribution that they can make. Our National Strategy for Economic Transformation sets out our aim to ensure that people have the skills they need at every stage of life to have rewarding careers. And of course, you can leave, and most people will leave, the armed forces at a relatively young age with another career ahead of them. Service leavers and veterans can and indeed must be part of this ambition if we are to succeed. We need to use existing talent here in Scotland, but we also need to grow the working age population. And as part of that, we will implement a focused talent attraction programme, including targeted interventions supported by the ministerial-chaired industry advisory group to attract key skills and talent from the rest of the UK. And that will include working with those supporting transition to civilian life to encourage individuals to make Scotland their home as they leave the military. New jobs emerging because of our transition to net zero will need new thinking, and we know that many existing jobs will require new and enhanced skill sets. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is also committed to increasing the number of veterans it employs, and we continue to explore a number of ways to achieve this, including through the Going Forward into Employment programme. We also had a stand at last year's Career Transition Partnership Careers Fair, where we had the opportunity to engage directly with Armed Forces personnel. And I should say that every MSP here can do the same. I do it for my annual job fair, make sure the Armed Forces are present and they're able to offer opportunities to young people and others in their area. That's also why in late 2020, the Scottish and Welsh Governments jointly funded Business in the Community to deliver a refresh of the Capitalising on Military Talent Toolkit to include information for employers on the benefits of employing military family members, to go back to a point that was raised earlier. And that toolkit looks to increase the knowledge of employers on how to employ partners successfully, you know, letting them know the particular pressures that a spouse, for example, of somebody serving the military may face, but also how they can continue to participate and progress in the workforce. And we also remain committed to contributing to the Forces Families Jobs website, on which we provide links to adverts for Scottish Government jobs. We are, of course, also committed to helping veterans gain employment within the Scottish Government, and also have a proud track record in terms of reservists within the armed forces working within the civil service. But we also launched earlier this month our campaign working with the business community to help employers understand the benefits that veterans bring to the workplace. We've had the help in the past when I approached them personally, directly from the Prince of Wales, now the King, and we would certainly hope to see if we can continue that partnership to make sure, using his influence with some very large employers, that we can encourage employers to take on more members of the armed forces. Presiding Officer, our veterans and their families continue to contribute a huge amount to our society right across Scotland. I remain committed to providing the very best support for the entire veterans and armed forces community, and I look forward to the contributions of members and responding to these in due course. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, can I check, did you move the motion?
Moved.
Thank you very much. And so I now call on Edward Mountain to speak to and to move Amendment 8332.1. Around 8 minutes, please, Mr Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful that the Cabinet Secretary decided to move his motion so I can move my amendment to it as part of this debate. I'd also like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for the using Scottish Government time to bring this debate to the Chamber. Whilst the Minister and I have many differences, I think we share the fact that we both believe we served in the best parts of the armed forces in the world. So I'm pleased the Cabinet Secretary has listened to calls from members as well to hold debates on remembrance and support for services in our armed forces communities separately. They are both interlinked, but they are both distinct in their own right and merit their own separate debates. Long may this continue. Now, I'd like to pay tribute to everything that our armed forces communities do for this country. Their contribution is not just made on the front line, sometimes it's close to home, as we saw during the pandemic. That's why local authorities, I believe, should always celebrate Armed Forces Day, something which I note with sadness the Highland Council has forgotten to do for a while, which is a matter I'll be raising with them. We must remember that a lot of good that our armed forces do, it goes hidden and unnoticed. For example, we should never forget the very strong ties that local bases develop with their local communities. You only have to look at RAF Lossiemouth, who hosts things like the Community Amateur Dramatics Club, and the fact that they were prepared to shift their fence to allow the establishment of a medical practice. If you look at RAF Kinloss, they also play a large part in the local communities, promoting good causes. And one should never forget the Army at Fort George provides training facilities for the best football club in Scotland, Inverness Caledonian Thistle. These are the hidden contributions which embed our armed forces within their communities. And our servicemen, whilst they're always here for us, we should make sure we support them in return. They are prepared to give their all, we should never forget, for our freedoms. So it's only right that we are prepared to support our veterans when it comes to health, housing and employment. It is, after all, only a small price to pay, but worth every penny. That's why I welcome the combined approach that has been taken by the UK government and the three devolved governments to create a joint strategy for our veterans. This collective effort deserves praise and shows how working together can bring about serious progress. We've reached the halfway point of this 10-year strategy, so now would be a good time to reflect upon its achievement. In the recent years, we've seen the promotion of modern apprenticeships to early service leavers, providing them with vital new skills and career opportunities, the tackling of disadvantages faced by veterans and families when they require social housing, and more investment in the Scottish Veterans Fund, which is crucial for supporting charities delivering support to our armed service personnel. And to give credit where credit is due, credit must be given to the Scottish Government for the part they've played in this. All governments have played parts in this, and they've all progressed well. The UK Government has introduced a relief on national insurance contributions for employers who take on veterans in their first 12 months post-service. That's good news. The UK Government has also just launched a review into welfare provisions for veterans to identify any gaps or duplication in support. Of course, all of these actions are built on the principles of the Armed Services Covenant, which we and the Scottish Conservatives propose should be enshrined within Scottish law. It is right to do so. Doing so, in my mind, would enhance the support given to veterans and their families, whether that's access to education, securing a home, building a new career, or receiving the right healthcare. There's always much more that can be done, and that's what we should strive to do. And that was the point that was made to me recently when I met with the Scottish Veterans Commissioner. Homelessness remains a huge challenge, with the latest figures, I believe, showing that 640 veterans are assessed as homeless across Scotland. This is truly shameful. No one should be without a home, especially those who've sacrificed everything or been prepared to sacrifice everything to protect our country. I am encouraged that the UK government is delivering a further 8.5 million of funding to end veterans' homelessness in 2023 in England. And I would like to see a similarly strong commitment made by the Scottish government. And I'm not convinced that the refreshed veterans strategy goes far enough in this area. Yes, I will.
Cabinet Secretary.
Sure.
I wonder if I could say, first, thank everyone for taking the intervention. Just to say that if he's able to state the proportion of veterans that are homeless as a proportion of the general population. And also, if he's saying that the work being done by, and it's very much like a UK government speech, if the work being done by the UK government in relation to veterans should result in consequentials coming to Scotland for that work, because if, after all, it is work that's been done. And we have in this Parliament no statutory responsibility for veterans, so we choose to spend the money that we do. Should we not get the consequentials as well?
Edward Benton.
Well, typical of a Marine to try and ambush you, and probably done it quite successfully. I cannot give you the exact numbers of the amount of people who are homeless in relation to veterans to other members of the public. But as far as actually resolving the homelessness is concerned, I believe it's everyone's responsibility. And I believe that any help that the UK government could be able to give to the Scottish government should be given to them, because I think it's vital that we ensure veterans are not homeless. And I'm happy to campaign with the Minister on that point if he wants me to. Presiding Officer, have I time to take another intervention?
Yes, there's time in hand. Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Edward Mountain for taking the intervention. This is not meant as a criticism, but surely one homeless veteran in Scotland is one homeless veteran too many.
Yeah. Edward Mountain.
Can I just say yes? Is that the simple answer? Yeah, I think it is the simple answer, because any veteran should have a home and should have access to a home. And I believe it's wrong if they don't have that. So the answer is simply yes. And I think that also when it comes to what else can be done is on the healthcare provision. And I do recognise that good work has been achieved in this area with the creation of veterans champions as points of contact within NHS boards. But it is difficult and we need to get it better. I certainly know when I was discharged, my medical records never followed me anywhere, which was not to my advantage, and it's not to the advantage of any soldier if their medical records cannot be made available to their GP. There may be times, of course, when those medical records need to be, items of those medical records need to be removed, just for a security point of view, but I think in principle those should follow it. I would also say that on the champions within NHS boards, it's supported by the Armed Forces Covenant Trust, so I'm pleased to say we were able to extend funding for veterans champions through to March 2024. But there are big questions what's going to happen beyond that date, and it'd be good to hear from the Cabinet Secretary when he's closing as to what the long-term support can be offered by the Scottish Government to ensure the continuation of this vital scheme. Finally, members will be aware in previous debates I've called for an end to a threat to the repeated historic allegations of abuse inquiries and have raised the issue of Dennis Hutchins from my regiment. I'm not going to talk in detail about this today, but I'm going to leave everyone with this simple question. Is it right that elderly and terminally ill veterans are hauled before courts to face legal action over the decisions they made to defend the country and their freedoms? Are we indeed comfortable that in facing these court trials, they may well die, as indeed Dennis Hutchins did? I will say no more than that, Presiding Officer, except to say that we should never underestimate the dangers our servicemen and women face, and we should never forget that they are prepared to make the ultimate sacrifice. And for that reason, as a country, we owe them a debt of gratitude, and we also should owe them the principle of looking after them when they've completed their services, as they return into civilian life. That moral obligation falls upon all governments across the United Kingdom. The 5 to 10 year strategy, the 5 years into a 10 year strategy, I believe there's still work for this government to do. But they have made a commendable start, and for that I would like to pay them credit. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call on Paul Sweeney to speak to and to move Amendment 8332.2. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I am pleased to open this debate for the Labour Party and to move the amendment in my name. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the valuable opportunity to speak on a matter that all of us in this chamber at the moment must be passionate about, which is to support veterans and their families in any way that is practical and necessary. And in that spirit, Labour will be supporting the government motion this evening. It is Labour's view that the qualifications, skills and experience of service leavers and veterans, whether reserve or regular, are undervalued and poorly recognised. The Scottish Government have a duty to right this wrong and indignity, and despite the unique impacts that the pandemic and cost of living crisis have had on many veterans and the laudable efforts of the Government to make progress, there is much more that needs to be done. And that is partly why we're having this debate today, to put in place the support that's tailored and to increase the funding to ensure there's the capacity out there in our country to meet the scale of this challenge. And all of us who feel passionately about supporting veterans must do more to promote the proper use of the term, particularly among early service leavers. Often early service leavers or reservists are those who have left under difficult circumstances, struggle to identify or reluctant to identify themselves as veterans, which they are entitled to do, whether they serve for decades, with an illustrious career, or undertook simply one day of basic training. And when the Scottish Government announced it would include a question in the 2022 census about service in the armed forces, this was very welcome indeed, as it would give the opportunity for advocacy organisations and others engaged about these issues to tangible data from which to direct their outreach work. And I hope the Cabinet Secretary may be able to confirm when this data might be available. Deputy Presiding Officer, I wish to turn now to a celebration of the work already been done in the area of support for veterans and their families, both in employment and in other areas. I think it's important to acknowledge that there is much good work being done already in support for ex-service personnel to take up employment in the civilian world. Large organisations such as Barclays, FDM Group and Network Rail have dedicated programmes for ex-service personnel to support a transition from armed forces working environments to a civilian one. Many other businesses, organisations and local authorities have committed to the Armed Forces Covenant to treat personnel, veterans and their families fairly, and I'd like to put on record my admiration for those who sign this important pledge and, most importantly, adhere to those values. Of course, Labour supports establishing clear statutory targets to underpin delivery of the Armed Forces Covenant to provide a central focal point for supporting the anecdotal evidence we have out there of good practice. The organisations undertaking this work know that we in this chamber also understand, which is that veterans and their families bring admirable qualities and values learned in the armed forces communities and apply this to their work to the benefit of all they come into contact with. And if they are provided with the right support and transitionary training, veterans and their family members are worth their weight in gold and are some of our best citizens. Indeed, recently visiting RAF Lossiemouth and at Lookers Garrison, there was a big issue raised, as was alluded to by Jamie Green earlier, that actually supporting those who are currently serving to maintain their position with the resilience of their families around them is critical as well. And that requires greater liaison between the Scottish Government, local authorities and the Ministry of Defence to ensure that the adequate housing supply is available, childcare facilities are there and support for things like starting up local businesses or contacting local professions to get them adequately engaged and integrated into local communities. And in Glasgow, SAFA and Glasgow City Council jointly support the activity of Glasgow's Helping Heroes. Since 2010, they have provided a holistic service providing advice and support on matters including housing and homelessness, employability and training, financial issues, welfare benefits and health issues. And I've witnessed firsthand the wonderful work that Rachel Tribble and her team do that is so transformative to service users. It is no exaggeration to say that their work can greatly improve and even save lives. Indeed, on Tuesday evening, it was my great pleasure to host SAFA's Glasgow Helping Heroes here in the Parliament to celebrate their work and consider the evaluation report commissioned as part of the organisation's 10th anniversary. And this report, a vital service enabling our armed forces community to thrive, confirms that the social return on investment of such services is enormous and tangible. Researchers from the University of Stirling and Glasgow Caledonian concluded that for every pound that was spent on the Glasgow's Helping Heroes service, the social value of the result of this investment was £6.63. This figure was reflective of a time when COVID-19 restrictions were in place, and it is estimated that in normal times, the return could be as much as £11.68, an amazing return on investment and something we should look at as a national exemplar. And that is why I ask the Cabinet Secretary and members across this chamber to support the amendment in my name today. Veterans and their families are not any more likely to struggle with unemployment than those in wider society, but it is undeniable that they face unique challenges when working on Civvy Street. And a holistic approach to support modelled by Glasgow's Helping Heroes will ensure that all those in our armed forces communities can thrive and continue to make our workplaces more diverse and ever more successful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. And we now move to the open debate. I would advise members that there is quite a bit of time in hand, should they wish to make additional points in their contributions or take or make interventions. And I call on Graeme Day to be followed by Russell Finlay. Mr. Day.
Rare indeed, Presiding Officer, to be encouraged to avoid brevity. Presiding Officer, can I, as Edward Mountain did, warmly welcome today's debate? As a Parliament, we've established a pattern of general debates around the armed forces and veterans community and their needs, expanded upon perhaps only when we're considering the content of occasional reports by the Veterans Commissioner. So to have the chance to drill down into a key particular aspect of all of this, I think it's quite useful. And I say that from a deeply personal perspective, because 2 years on from ending my tenure as Veterans Minister, I still retain a very keen interest in all matters armed forces and veterans community-wise. And I very much look forward to interrogating the progress made regarding employment of the 2,000 or so serving personnel who leave the military and settle in Scotland each year, not to mention their families. The progress that's been made, of course, is entirely down to partnership working between governments, local and national, the public and private sectors, and of course our veterans' charitable sector. But let's be candid about something. This isn't just about doing the right thing by these groups. If we're honest, it's also about exploiting a talent source that none of us can afford to ignore. I'm all for acknowledging publicly those employers who make a virtue of recruiting from the armed forces community, but we should be clear that they do this not out of altruism, but because they have recognised they are sourcing from a skilled and reliable employment pool. A few years ago, BT conducted a survey of their workforce. They looked at the attributes of the veterans cohort set against the wider workforce. They discovered the former had a 40% better attendance record. So well done those firms and organisations who have a track record in this area. But let's see their involvement for what it is, a reflection of the employability of the individuals being produced by the services. And what we need is more of these businesses and organisations, public and private sector, evangelising on the benefits of hiring from the forces. And I know the Scottish Government are actively encouraging that. However, having said all of that, let me pay tribute to those employers who've looked beyond just those leaving the services and have sought to provide employment opportunities for spouses and partners of serving personnel, of which Barclays would be a fine example, because it can be extremely difficult for those spouses and partners to find worthwhile jobs when they have had to leave behind family support networks and have childcare responsibilities to consider. Of all the visits I made and the groups I met during my tenure as Veterans Minister, few left as lasting an impression as those which involved the partners and spouses of serving personnel, be that at Faz Lane or the self-help can-do hub set up at Lookers. If we owe our servicemen and women every assistance to secure gainful employment when they move on, then our obligation to their spouses and partners while they remain in service is no less. And that's why I very much welcome the positive relationship which continues between the Scottish Government and the Forces Families Federation and the ongoing involvement in the Forces Families Jobs website. The Federation, I think, as many of us know here, do sterling work promoting and advocating for those they represent. I'm pleased, Presiding Officer, to note the way in which a particular Scottish Government initiative has morphed since 2018, and that's around work that was designed to make it easier for employers and educational institutions to recognise the skills and expertise of those leaving the forces. Initially, that took the form of giving military, specifically infantry, qualifications a civilian translation, and that served those affected well. But it's been developed into a more holistic approach, and we now have the SCQF Military Skills and Qualification Discovery Tool that the Cabinet Secretary referenced earlier, which I think I'm right in saying now covers 45 job roles all told. I should though acknowledge, and this refers to Martin Whitfield's initial point, I should though acknowledge the clear progress that's been made by the Army, for example, in career development work and furnishing their personnel with formal qualifications, which will aid them when it comes to finding work when they leave. The Army has historically been lax in this regard, perhaps fearful that to provide these qualifications would encourage people to leave at a time where retention and recruitment remains a very big issue. But on a recent visit, to the same visit that Paul Sweeney made to Lookers Station, I was very heartened to hear direct from serving personnel of the qualification opportunities, indeed the encouragement to go for those qualifications they were receiving. Going back to that subject of morphing, of course, the Veterans Employability Strategic Group has also undergone considerable change since the Cabinet Secretary established it in 2017. Not the least significant change was the adoption of a new co-chair approach involving the appointment of Sue Bomfrey, who was then an HR director at Barclays. As Keith Brown's successor, I made that appointment, having been hugely impressed by the work Sue had led at Barclays around employing veterans, but just as importantly, spouses. The ambition was to have more private sector employers involved, not just those from the public and third sectors. And I hope the Cabinet Secretary, in closing, might be able to tell us of the progress the VESG has led. Otherwise, I'm going to regret highlighting my role in the changes that I noted. President Officer, one of the limited number of positives to come out of the pandemic was the Scottish Government as an institution seeing up close just how multi-skilled our armed forces are. I well recall meeting with a group of Army logistics experts operating out of St Andrew's House who'd be drafted in to support the NHS around distribution of key items. Chatting to the team, I encouraged them when they went out into the field not to compromise on their can-do attitude and approach, which they didn't. And the impression they left has been tangible. For example, I understand since 2021 around 50 veterans have joined the government staff ranks. That's welcome, and clearly there's scope to build on it. But the more this cohort's talents are experienced firsthand, the more I suspect it will be seen as an employment pool worthy of fishing in. And that goes for employers way beyond the Scottish Government itself. So I'm pleased to see the government fulfilling its programme for government commitment to improve employment opportunities for serving personnel when their time in the forces ends, and with a particular focus on the SME sector, because it's not just large companies and organisations who would benefit from employing these individuals. So to conclude, President Officer, we've made progress on improving the employment offering for spouses of serving personnel and veterans, but there is more to do. President Officer.
Thank you, Mr Day. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Christine Graham. Mr Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. I begin by echoing the words of my colleague Edward Mountain and the Cabinet Secretary about the sacrifices made by veterans and their families, and indeed to recognise both for their own service. Now, our brave servicemen and women make immense sacrifices to keep our country safe and secure. They serve our nation with honour and distinction, and it's our duty to ensure that they are provided with the best possible support upon their return to civilian life. We owe them a debt that can never really be repaid in full. We must make every effort to give the 250,000 veterans who live in Scotland all the support they deserve. And one of the key areas of that support is employment. Many veterans struggle to find work when they leave the armed forces, despite having a wealth of skills and experience. This is especially true for those who have been injured in the line of duty, whether that be physically or mentally. Now, since 2021, the UK Government has granted 12 months relief on national insurance contributions to employers for new veterans who they take on. I also welcome the work between the UK and Scottish governments in the area of employment. The Joint Strategy for Our Veterans, launched in 2018, was a great example of what can be achieved when both of Scotland's governments work together constructively in things that really do matter. As Chris Hughes of Veterans Scotland said at the time, it was particularly refreshing to see the governments across the UK come together to take collective ownership of the strategy and put the needs of the veteran community before party politics, an achievement that has been widely applauded by stakeholders. This joint strategy will run for 10 years, but it's already been effective. Although, as we all acknowledge, we must continue updating and refreshing it as new evidence is gathered. In that light, it was positive to see the Cabinet Secretary update the action plan for veterans last August, and I expect he'll keep it under continual review. The strategy has several strands, but one of the key themes was supporting veterans into employment and furthering the career opportunities available to them. The Scottish and UK governments have progressed that key aim by working in collaboration where possible. A strong and positive example has been set by Skills Development Scotland's collaboration with the MOD. This supports career transitions and increases career guidance for armed forces personnel entering their resettlement period. I would be keen to see the Scottish and UK governments explore any other areas where they can work together, especially in respect of employment opportunities. I'd be supportive of any initiatives that could establish further collaboration of this nature. Now, in my own parliamentary region, the West of Scotland, there are good examples of projects bringing together organisations across the public sector that seek to help veterans. I refer to a joint initiative between the University of the West of Scotland, NHS Lanarkshire, and the St John and Red Cross Defence Medical Welfare Service, which is a charity providing medical welfare to those who operate on the front line, whether that be military, police or the health service. Now, this initiative was awarded a grant to examine how welfare support and technology can benefit isolated veterans. The UK government recently announced that projects would share funding of £5 million with 22 other projects, all with the goal of driving forward cutting-edge treatments and technologies to support veterans' healthcare. Now, these projects have been launched to help the physical and mental health of veterans, and it's a great achievement for the University of the West of Scotland to gain funding of this kind for such innovative research. I had the recent privilege of visiting the university's main Paisley campus to speak with some impressive young journalism students, which made me feel very old indeed. Presiding officer, it was also encouraging to see the UK government launch a review at the beginning of this month into welfare provision for veterans. This seeks to identify gaps in support and better align the workings of a range of support services with the needs of the veteran community. It also aims to enhance the quality of the services that veterans receive. I will look forward to the outcome of that review, which I'm confident will improve the current system for veterans and their families. Now, my party has also proposed introducing a new top-up benefit to support veterans in receipt of universal credit using the devolved powers the Scottish Parliament now has over welfare. We believe that should happen alongside an Armed Forces and Veterans Bill to further enshrine the voluntary Armed Forces Covenant into law and guarantee access to a variety of key services. Scotland has long played a pivotal and proud role in UK military history. As I've already said, we owe an enormous debt of gratitude to our service men and women. Saying that is the easy part, but our gratitude must extend beyond warm words into firm action, some of which I've touched on today. It's commendable that the UK and Scottish governments are focused on working together to uphold our commitment to veterans. And I hope to see that continue, and I'm pleased to support the government motion today and the amendment in the name of Edward Mountain. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. And I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Neil Bibby. Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm privileged to have within my constituency Glencorse Barracks at Pennycook, home of 2 Scots 2nd Battalion, the Royal Regiment of Scotland, and across the road and up the hill at Milton Bridge Army Homes. I've visited both, but I will in due course refer to my meeting with the wives and partners and the particular issues they face. And I agree with the Cabinet Secretary that their support is essential in sustaining the morale of our service personnel. But the first, though, obvious observation to make is that the term veterans embraces many different people. Those who've had a short service career, those long-serving, those who've been on the front line in places of conflict, in combat or peacekeeping, and those who have not. There are those who live alone and others with parents, partners and parental responsibilities. There are those who have suffered life-changing injuries, those with combat stress, and that list is not exhaustive. One size, therefore, does not fit all, but there are common experiences. But first, I'll touch on the issue of data, which is not a boring topic, but fundamental to identifying the breadth of the challenges and meeting them. I note, therefore, that for the first time in the Scottish 2022 census, there was a question on previous experience in the armed forces. As I understand it, this has yet to be published, but that will be very useful. What we do know is that there are particular challenges facing our servicemen and women as they re-enter the civilian community. From living and working in a culture of conformity, of structure, of obedience, of rank, of service tours, taking away for months on end, and with housing and health access all provided, of guaranteed income, all contrast starkly with a life in a civilian community. From tours taking you from family and friends and partners to the world of the civilian, where decisions, choices have to be made by you that perhaps were previously made for you. You're home most of the time. You have to make your own health provision, find work, fit in. The comradeship that came with the job may be distant, and you have to make new social ties. This isn't just hard for you, but it's often very hard for family. Your partner or wife will have run a household without you for months on end, made all the day-to-day decisions. Even when you're on leave, there have to be adjustments all round. This is true of any children too. You have to fit back into a domestic household which functioned quite well without you. If you've returned from some horror overseas, factor that in. Finding... Yes, certainly.
Graham Day.
Christine Graham gave away, and she makes some very valid points. But she also recognised that one of the most challenged cohorts are the single early service weavers, who I would contend are a growing issue for us to address.
Christine. Indeed, I tried to cover what the list wasn't exhaustive. Funding to provide routes to adjustment, of course, helps, as well as all the person-to-person support. And I note that in 2021-23, 750,000 has been put in to support work and health, well-being and quality of life, and that's been expanded to include all veterans over 60 instead of 65. But I want to dedicate the rest of my time to veterans, partners and family, especially if there are children. After all, wherever father, mother or partner goes, they often have to follow, changing homes and schools and adapting to yet another community. Though I have to say that Pennycook has welcomed both in schools and the community at large those stationed at Glencross. Indeed, when the barracks was threatened with closure by the MOD, the community rallied round to save it, and it has been reprieved. But it's difficult for wife or partner to hold down a career when you're on the move. Children too may find months of settling in one school and then they're off to another. Meeting wives and partners of servicemen from Glencross, I was made very aware of the restrictions on their lives, which I make clear they accept without complaint, and supported each other, especially when a partner was being sent on a long tour to a difficult part of the world. But apart from setting up online businesses, the mobility of their partners obviously prevented them in many respects from following careers. This must mean when eventually their armed forces partners ended their final tour of duty, even more huge adjustments have to be made all round. On discharge, a home has to be found, GP registration, and I note the reference the Cabinet Secretary made and Edward Mountain to the importance of the MOD ensuring prompt transfer of medical records. Then there are schools and not the least employment. This, while often two people, let alone any children, have to get used to being with each other 24/7. For some, this transition simply doesn't work. There can be marriage and relationship breakups with all the fallout that can be predicted. Some turn to alcohol and indeed drugs, perhaps leading for some in time to homelessness and even imprisonment. Lack of employment can be a major component of this. They have skills which can be carried over into civilian life, and these should be utilised. Indeed, there are staff in here, especially in security roles, who have a background in military service. Deputy Presiding Officer, our veterans make this huge adjustment to civilian life, and it's not just essential, it is just, given the job that they have done on our behalf, perhaps including dreadful sights they may have seen that they will carry with them throughout their lives that we help them. But I conclude by asking the Cabinet Secretary, in his summing up, and I know to some extent he's already addressed this, how support is extended to a veteran's immediate family, the parents, the partners, the wives, and indeed the children, when that transition becomes a reality with all the challenges I've touched upon, both private, personal and public, which will undoubtedly follow. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Neil Bibby to be followed by Audrey Nicol. Mr Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm proud to speak in this debate which honours our veterans and their families and which seeks to advance their important contribution to communities across our nation. This is an important and necessary debate on employment support for veterans and a rise in support of the amendment in the name of my Labour colleague Paul Sweeney, and I agree with much that he, the Cabinet Secretary and every member has said. Presiding Officer, over many, many years our service personnel have been delivering security for the people of Scotland and the UK at home and overseas. I doubt any of us would dispute that those who have served our country so well deserve the very best support as they make the transition back into civilian life. As well as the well-documented healthcare and housing needs, these days we also increasingly need to support veterans into employment opportunities. As Poppy Scotland and others have highlighted, most veterans are no longer at retirement age when they leave the armed forces. Presiding officer, ensuring that our armed forces personnel have support and assistance to transition into employment is therefore vitally important. It's important that that journey is started and enabled as early as possible in the resettlement process. It's important first and foremost for the individuals involved as well as their families. As we've already heard, transitioning to civilian life can be difficult and disorientating for veterans, especially if they're also learning to live with physical and mental injuries. Employment is therefore vital, firstly for reintegration and mental health, providing a meaning, a sense of purpose, structure and routine in one's life. Just as important as paying the bills, and we need to recognise the current cost of living crisis will be having a particular impact on our veterans. Veterans have an enormous social and economic contribution to make to our communities, and we have a moral obligation to those who have protected us and our families to ensure we now honour the moral contract we have with them and their families during transition and beyond. Presiding officer, like Russell Finlay, I represent West of Scotland and I'm privileged to have many examples of civil society helping our veterans and organisations working to honour and support our veterans. Erskine, Scotland's largest veterans charity, has been caring for veterans across Scotland since 1916. Through their care homes, veterans village and activity centres, Erskine offers a very special blend of dedicated care, compassion and understanding to residents and their families. I've been proud to visit them on a number of occasions and I'm incredibly fortunate to meet many of the resident staff who are led ably by Ian Cumming. I was delighted in return to show a group of veterans around the building and in this chamber just a few weeks ago. Presiding officer, Renfrewshire is also home to a remarkable new social enterprise that is blazing a trail in terms of veterans' employability. Scotland's bravest manufacturing company is a division of the Royal British Legion Industries. Their factory is commercially viable. It produces signs, panels, high-quality digital printing. It also provides opportunities for many, including veterans who are learning to live with an injury or disability. Again, I've visited this enterprise and seen it for myself, and I know a number of other members have done likewise. It's truly inspiring and hopefully a model that can be replicated across the industry and the country. There's obviously more examples as well of great work being done by organisations, and I commend them all. However, Presiding Officer, all is not well. Care for our veterans cannot be left to civil society alone. If the first duty of government is to protect its citizens, then its next duty must be to protect and honour the men and women who do the protecting. It is unacceptable that many veterans continue to experience difficulty in accessing employment and skills development. Yes, sir.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Neil Bibby for taking the intervention. And just to say that he mentioned the word duty, and of course, it's largely a moral duty in relation to the Scottish Government, but there is something of a legal duty in relation to the Covenant. I just wonder, though, that if what is being said, we have a legal or a statutory duty, is he also willing to, along with Edward Mountain and myself, campaign to the UK Government to say that we need to have the consequential funding in order to further those services to veterans?
Neil Bibby.
I'm going to come into that, and I'm happy to look into the further issues around the funding, because clearly if we've got legal duties, there needs to be the funding that follows from that. We must recognise the role our armed forces played in the pandemic, as Graeme Day did, and at the same time recognise the significant impact the pandemic has had on many veterans. It's incumbent now upon both the Scottish and UK governments to ensure they have the support they need. I commend the employability initiatives and other actions set out by the Scottish Government in November last year, although I must note that many employability initiatives are delivered through local employability partnerships at a local authority level. And in terms of funding, the appalling cuts inflicted upon councils in last month's budgets therefore appear to represent a lack of joined-up thinking in that regard. There are other practical issues that we need to consider. Jamie Green mentioned childcare at the very start of this debate. But also, for example, we need to connect our veterans to support via transport. And how do we, for example, support veterans to connect that support when, on a very practical measure, the bus stop at Erskine's Veterans Village has been moved too far away for many residents and visitors to comfortably reach it? This is an issue that's been raised with me by my constituent, James Gillies. It highlights the deficiencies in our bus services and the need for people not just to have bus passes, but buses on which to use them. And I hope the bus companies involved will reconsider what's happening there. The UK government, unfortunately, meanwhile, has broken too many promises to our veterans over the past 13 years, as highlighted repeatedly by Johnny Mercer, MP. There are missed waiting time targets on veterans' mental health, a failure to deliver ID cards to speed up access to vital services, and many former personnel report negative experiences when claiming compensation. The Armed Forces Act, meanwhile, places a duty to deliver the Armed Forces Covenant on all manner of public bodies, but many veterans I speak to feel it lets the UK government ministers off the hook. Scottish Labour, by contrast, supports establishing clear statutory targets to underpin delivery of the Armed Forces Covenant. A future UK Labour government is fully committed to fully incorporating the Armed Forces Covenant into law and scrapping visa fees for non-UK veterans and their families after 4 years of service. Labour has also launched a UK-wide listening campaign, Veterans Voices. Above all, Presiding Officer, we must work with veterans to ensure they receive the employability and other support they deserve. And to ensure that, at both Scottish and UK government levels, we fulfil the sacred moral contract that our society makes with those who serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Bibby. I now call Audrey Nicol to be followed by Jamie Green. Ms Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Likewise, I am very pleased to speak in this debate this afternoon that acknowledges the significant contribution veterans make on their return to civilian life following service in our military. Men and women leave the military for very different reasons: injury, ill health, personal circumstances on completion of their service. For many, their circumstances are such that they can consider and embark on a new work life. By virtue of their training, their job roles and experiences, many service leavers return with invaluable skills, qualifications and knowledge. Mechanics, engineers, doctors, plumbers, lawyers. And leavers also have highly developed personal skills, effective communication, problem solving, the ability to work in a team, leadership, all transferable into a new and fulfilling work role that will benefit not only them and their family, but their community and local economy. Of course, underpinning a successful transition are the people who stand beside them, their families that have also essentially served their country. Partners are an important protective factor, providing emotional, practical, and financial help while a service leaver considers their next steps. However, we know for some, transition can be very difficult. Compromised mental and physical health, alcohol use, domestic abuse, personal debt, even grievance are well-documented vulnerability factors that can take their toll at a time of great change. An added vulnerability factor for many is the current cost of living crisis, as other members have mentioned. And I'm pleased that the Scottish Government Veterans Fund, that has supported a range of fantastic projects for veterans over a number of years, has been doubled this year to ensure that veterans and their families have the support they need. The extent to which employment support has developed in recent years is very welcome, and I'm pleased the Veterans Employability Strategic Group now has membership from the private sector, an important step in recognising the benefit of employing veterans, not least of all as we grapple with labour shortages across Scotland. The energy sector is one of the fastest growing sectors in our economy and already offering many employment opportunities suited to former and transitioning military personnel. And according to Dr. Alex Tom, Workforce Employment Manager for Offshore Energies UK, the energy sector provides highly skilled and well rewarded employment opportunities. And to meet its future commitments, this sector is already working to to match industry job profiles with military roles, identifying transferable positions and training and conversion opportunities. And energy firms are increasingly recognising the benefits of recruiting men and women from the armed forces. Qualities such as team leadership, organisational skills and technical knowledge are all highly prized by the sector, and career opportunities exist in the fields of engineering, project management, health and safety and the skilled trades. And in my constituency in the North East, I regularly speak to energy sector businesses that are actively recruiting a broad range of talent and skills in an extremely competitive labour market. As such, our veteran community has a strong contribution to make to our Scottish renewables industry. And earlier this week, I visited the newly constructed South Harbour in my constituency and heard that Port of Aberdeen proactively promotes employment opportunities to groups that represent military veterans. And another sector actively recruiting veterans is the cyberspace. Cybersecurity is a growing industry, with cyber attacks becoming a growing concern for businesses in all sectors in Scotland, and Scotland is not exempt from this. And the security training, experience and skills service leavers have makes them an ideal candidate for a range of cyber and information security roles. There are clear parallels. Cybersecurity requires analysis of threats and vulnerabilities, and veterans not only live and breathe security, but they may also have personal and professional qualities that lend themselves to this role. And I will.
Graham Day.
Thank you, President Officer. She makes some very good points. I just tell her, developing her theme about particular talents. RM Condor, 4-5 Commander, who Keith Brown and I met today, it's emerged that their talents around health and safety, because of the work they carry out, have a translation into civilian life, but also mental health support because of the TRIM training. So I think she makes a very good point about that, and I wonder if she would acknowledge the point I've made.
Audrey Nicholas, I can give you the time.
Thank Graham Day for his intervention, and I would absolutely agree with the point that he's making, that not only are veterans bringing professional experience, but they're bringing many personal attributes, just as you've highlighted. And some veterans will also have existing security clearances and leave the military with IT and cybersecurity qualifications that mean they can literally walk into a new role. Presiding Officer, these are only two examples of sectors benefiting from our veteran community, and I'm acutely aware pathways to employment can still be challenging for many service leavers. And I was pleased to hear about the range of employment support outlined by the Cabinet Secretary earlier on in opening this debate. And I'm proud of the long tradition of support in place in Scotland for veterans across education, housing, healthcare and employment. However, we all know there is much to do. So to conclude, we owe our veterans a huge debt of gratitude. As such, it is incumbent on us to do everything we can to ensure they can access the support, training and education they need. And as a member of the military family myself, I will certainly do my bit within that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Nicholl. And I call Jamie Green to be followed by Carol Mochan for a generous 6 minutes, Mr Green.
Very generous of you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and all members who have contributed thus far in this, what I think is a very good debate. It's not without its politics, but nor should it be. We're in Parliament after all. And I think it goes without saying there genuinely is cross-party sentiment here that we do owe a great amount of thanks and gratitude to those who serve our country, have served our country, and indeed those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice. Not everyone is able to come back and be re-employed or readjust to society, because many don't come home at all. We also have the great privilege of having amongst us those who have served, including in the two front benches here today, but also throughout the staff in the Parliament. Many of us in our own political offices and throughout parliamentary staff either have served or even currently serve through the reserves. And I think we owe them all a huge thanks today. Of course, many of us, as we've discussed many times in this Parliament, have very personal experiences and relationships with the armed forces through friends and family who served, going as far back as the First and Second World Wars, but even more recently in other ways of service. As I was doing some research, as my staff were doing some research for me, ahead of today's debate, rummaging through the local papers, we pulled out some really interesting anecdotes and stories. And the first one I did want to share, and that was of Tommy McVeigh, who was a Greenock pilot who shot down an enemy plane in World War II. He was attacked by a German plane, which fatally injured the pilot, a 24-year-old pilot, leaving Tommy to take control of the plane himself. And indeed, he managed to do so and made it back home. He survived, he got married, he had a wife and kids. In fact, his nephew is one of the councillors in Inverclyde Council. But like so many veterans, he really struggled and carried the weight of that experience with him throughout his whole life. And I think many veterans do, but don't share it and talk about it. And of course, those are the wars which occupy our TV channels, the ones we talk about the most. But not all veterans necessarily go to war. Not all veterans were on the front line. Many people who serve also serve in places of famine. They serve in places of genocide. They perform peacekeeping missions and also work in a huge amount of natural disasters. And as we've learned over the last few years, pandemics as well. Trauma can actually occur pretty much in anywhere it is met with, in many places and in many ways as well. And I wanted to say that because I want to challenge, I think, what the overused notion of what is a veteran. I think there is a stereotype out there that is often used, and it's often a male, somebody who's war-torn, somebody who's perhaps injured, somebody who's perhaps homeless or suffering from addiction or mental health breakdown or PTSD and so on. And of course, that all that exists, and I'm going to talk a bit about that as well. But I think anyone who's retired from service and anyone who's come back into society in that way is a veteran. Anyone is a veteran. Many of them go on to have great lives. Many of them go on to re-employment and opportunities. Many of them go into the private sector. And again, I'm going to talk about that in a second. Many even go back into the forces as reserves, sometimes part-time, but often full-time, as they come back to use the skills that they developed. They are all veterans, too. So much so, there's estimates around of around 250,000 veterans in Scotland. And I think what we have heard today, you know, when you brush away the politics, is the fact that both of Scotland's governments have been working together constructively, directly through, I think, through ministerial level, but also in the civil service, which is important. And they won't always get it right, and those relationships aren't always perfect. But it's only if not just both levels of national government, but also local government gets involved, I think, can we truly paint a picture of improving outcomes. And I have name-checked the UK Minister for Defence for Veterans, Mr. Johnny Mercer, in this chamber before. I should also probably mention his wife as well, who has often got quite a lot to say. But I think it's important that there are role models and that people do have loud voices and are not afraid to use them, even within their own parties and governments. We should have more of that in politics. And just in one sec, because I do want to just state that the reason that's so important is that since 2001, there's been an estimated 2,000 former soldiers or veterans who believe to have taken their own lives. And I think that's quite a stark statistic, and I do want to mention it because whilst their understanding of mental health and PTSD has improved over the years, it's still depressingly high. I'm happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Hey, thank Jamie Green for giving way. Just to the point, if I could just quickly intervene to say that in relation to intergovernmental relationships, I've heard what's been said about the governments working together. I have never known it as bad as it is just now. I've met with every previous Secretary of State over the decade that I've been doing this. The current one refuses to meet. I've had people just ignoring letters, not having meetings across the board. So just to say that's a counterpoint to the fact, as Jamie Green says, there is some good work being done between the governments. On the other point, of course, a veteran, the definition of a veteran, somebody who's served even for half a day. And the point I was making in relation to homelessness, which she's mentioned, is quite right. Martin Whitefield says every person that's homeless is one too many. But in terms of the general population, whether it's homelessness or whether it's in terms of mental health or imprisonment, veterans are no more overrepresented in those categories. The horrible notion of mad, bad and sad is not true. Many veterans, the majority, successfully transition to civilian life.
Jamie Green, and then give you that time back.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, two very important points I think I'd like to reflect on. The first one is that if that is the case, and members of the Scottish Government are struggling to get appropriate communication from their counterparts in the UK Government, you're very right to raise that and mention. It's very right that we, in any way that we can, feed that back. I'm not a member of the UK Government, but they do have a building across the road, and I'm very happy to feed that back in any channels that I have. It's not appropriate and it's not respectful, Cabinet Secretary, and I agree with you on that. The second point, though, is on the issue of over-representation of veterans, either in states of distress, including homelessness. I don't think I'm not hearing anyone on our benches making the argument that they are over-represented, but they're there. You know, I think the estimate was that last year there were over 600 veterans who were homeless, and one is too many. And whilst I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary is, that he may not have a statutory duty to look after homeless veterans, he does have a statutory duty to look after homeless people, because ultimately they're still citizens of this country, whether they're a veteran or not. And it's in that vein that I'd like him to reflect on that. I could probably go on for another 6 minutes, so much more to say, but the issue of employment is the crux of the debate we're having today. The question really is why would you employ a veteran? It's why wouldn't you? And this is the point that Graham Day made, is what we are actually seeing is a bit of a brain drain in many of our armed forces, because many are seeing better terms and conditions in the private sector. Many have been attracted to contractors and private companies to even go and work for those contractors in the bases and the premises that they were once serving in. So they're disappearing out one end and coming in another. There's nothing wrong with that. It's good that may offer them better opportunities as they move on in the future, but it does create a bit of a struggle to get people in the door in our armed forces. Of course, we've talked a lot about families and children as well, and they are important. And one of the things I did want to reflect on is on my visits, and I have had a few visits now to RAF Lossiemouth and indeed to Faslane, is that when we talk to families and spouses of serving members of the forces, is the big thing that they struggle with is getting local employment that matches their own career paths, because they've had to probably put it on hold or in some cases give it up completely. You can't like for like do the same job in Inverness as you could, for example, in London. But they are struggling with childcare, and that is a devolved issue. You know, the provision of local childcare, of course, it may be a matter for local authorities, but you know, when you have an influx of thousands of people in the community, it does create some problems in terms of access to health services, education and childcare. And that's the crux of our amendment today, is let's look at all this in the whole and let's ensure that local authorities are a big part of the solution, not a big part of the problem. I think I'll close on that. I think we're on the right track, and I am encouraged by the tone of the debate today, although I do take on board the Cabinet Secretary's points about his difficulties with interaction with the UK Government. I hope that improves. And if it doesn't, please come and talk to those of us in this chamber that can improve that, if we can. I think our veterans deserve nothing less. In fact, they probably deserve a whole lot more. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Green. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Gordon MacDonald for, again, a generous 6 minutes, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to begin my contribution by acknowledging the importance of our veterans and armed forces and note the contribution they have made to Scotland and the wider world. And I would associate myself with the comments made by Jamie Green around that very wide understanding of what veterans actually are and what contribution they've made to the world. I would also wish, like other members have done, to pay my respect to those who have been injured or lost their lives in conflict or subsequently as a result of the impacts of the work and conflict that they have seen. Last year in this Parliament, we debated the mental health needs of veterans, and at that time I said I believed we should look at supporting veterans more holistically and do more to ensure our veterans have better access to employment and health services. However, we must ensure that services are cognisant of the fact that transition from a military career creates many challenges relating to housing, employment and, of course, mental and indeed physical health. Therefore, I am glad to see the Government bringing forward a debate looking at employment linked to housing, healthcare and multi-organisational support. Support for veterans must be coordinated and it must be person-centred, as is in the motion. Only by learning from the good practice will we see adequate, widespread support for our veterans. And this is, in fact, the very purpose of the Scottish Labour Amendment. To be clear in this motion that we should put in place national standards based on well-evidenced research of needs and outcomes to ensure the best possible quality of life for those leaving active service. And on Tuesday evening, I was honoured to attend the event sponsored by my colleague Paul Sweeney, and other members were there. The Glasgow Helping Heroes model provides an easily accessible service which is needs-led. Services come together around housing, finance, physical and mental health, and other supports which individuals can access at the time that is right for them. The report, as we've heard mentioned, Glasgow's Helping Heroes, a vital service, is an important read, and I would encourage members to go online and read that report. The personal stories detailed in the report give us the reality of difficult transitions, people often feeling alone with a sense of confusion about where to turn, and sometimes, which I think is really important, finding themselves unable to ask for help. The research rightly recognised the importance of having coordinated services such as GHH, not only in supporting the individual, but also the wider community who can benefit from the existence of such a service in their area and can direct people at the time that is right for them. Presiding Officer, my view is that every veteran is owed the right support to ensure that they're able to realise their potential and live full and successful lives after service. And in this chamber today, I think we've all demonstrated that is what we want. However, evidence does show that, as in many walks of life, social inequality has a predetermining factor on employment prospects for military service users. Some researchers have suggested that although high-ranking officers and soldiers are offered similar transition resources, those from the lower ranks find their opportunities underpinned by economic, social and structural inequality. And this inequality has significant effects on transitional employment outcomes. We must acknowledge that to ensure transitional needs are met in key areas such as housing, health and finance. Veterans, particularly those from poorer social economic backgrounds, do need that space to develop skills and make decisions about their future employment. Speaking with ex-service men and women recently, it is clear that pathways to employment can be difficult, and an extra layer of advice services such as the GGH model is essential. Recently, of course...
Paul Sweeney.
Thank my friend for giving me that point. But she also recognised that one of the key aspects of the Glasgow's Helping Heroes service, which is so powerful, is that it's veterans advising veterans, and that lived experience is often really critical, because often those who are employed and still serving in the armed forces who are advising people about to leave don't have those same insights as people who have been through the process already.
Carol Mochan.
I thank the member for that intervention, and yeah, that was very clear, and it was very powerfully demonstrated in one of the short videos that was shown at the event, that ability to support each other when you're out there in civilian life is absolutely invaluable. To move on, recently I was pleased to attend a local Ayrshire British Legion group breakfast. I attended with other local Labour councillor colleagues and was grateful to members of the British Legion group explaining to me the transition needs of those returning from active service to civilian life, particularly in a more rural area such as East Ayrshire and south of Scotland. I must say, I also found the stories from the family members very revealing, and it is the work with the individual and their wider support circle that struck me as extremely important. In concluding, Presiding Officer, as other MSPs have, like others I have, worked alongside members of the Armed Forces community during campaigns and outreach down the years. And in that time, I have been struck by the deep sense of commitment and dedication they have, not only to their own home, but to the wider community that they live in. And we need to capture that. Many of the charities and community groups we all work with on a daily basis have people with a forces background at their heart, using the skills they have learned to better improve the place that they call home. This includes groups like First Point Ayrshire Nairn, who provide first-class employment and housing support services, as well as a comfortable environment for those with military backgrounds to share their experiences, a very important part. If we can reflect a sense of that commitment today and help to deliver veterans the level of service they deserve, I think the motion amendment can achieve that. Then we put ourselves on a path towards paying back at least in some form our veterans for the service that they have given to our country. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. And I call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Again, a generous 6 minutes, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands has three army bases within its boundary, including Dreghorn, Redford Infantry and Redford Cavalry Barracks. In addition, we have Glencorse to the east and to the north, the former Army HQ at Craigie Hall, which is currently lying empty. I've visited the barracks in my constituency on a number of occasions, with the last occasion only a couple of weeks ago, where I met Aramac trainees and apprentices providing hospitality and housekeeping services at Dreghorn Barracks. Many of their employees are family members of serving Army personnel, ensuring that Army families have a better standard of living until the time comes that they transition into civilian life. It's no surprise that companies like Aramac employ Army family members, as a recent report by the Armed Forces Federation, Military Spousal Partner Employment, found that 30% of employers said that those military family members show resilience and determination, and 22% said that they were willing to go the extra mile in their work. Presiding Officer, it's estimated there are 100,000 veterans of working age and their families living in Scotland. The average age of those leaving the Army is 29, and as a result, they will spend more of their life in civilian employment than in Army life. These are highly trained individuals who have transferable skills that are often sought after by employers not only in Edinburgh but across Scotland. The Scottish Government's Programme for Government committed to securing improved opportunities for veterans and accepted the recommendations within the Scottish Veterans Commissioner's report on employment skills, learning and housing. This includes ensuring easier access to further learning and training, resulting in the Scottish Government providing additional funds to the Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework Partnership to develop a skills recognition tool for use on My World of Work website. This alignment of existing military skills and civilian qualifications should give veterans the best chance to compete for jobs when settling in Scotland. Improved connections to the business community by the Veterans Employment Strategic Group has resulted in membership from private sector employers for the first time. This presents an important step towards bridging the gap between public sector policy, service delivery partners and employers to the improved understanding of the benefit of employing veterans and ensuring they find suitable employment. It should also help to reach out to small and medium-sized companies as potential employers or as mentors to veterans looking to start their own business. The Forces Family Jobs website is a central portal for employment and training opportunities for military spouses and family members, which was launched in 2019. All employers who advertise on the Forces Family Jobs website have signed the Armed Forces Covenant, and a profile is provided for them to explain their individual commitment to being Forces Family friendly. The Scottish Government continues to work with Forces Family Jobs to post vacancies by directing to Work for Scotland, the Government's own job website. In addition, large public employers from the NHS to Police Scotland have designated websites or recruitment teams designed to support the recruitment of veterans. Presiding Officer, many soldiers will face other challenges when they leave the service, but the biggest difficulty facing those veterans in Edinburgh before they can even start seeking employment is that of finding a home when they leave the forces. Despite Scotland having some of the strongest homeless legislation in the world and all local authorities having a legal duty to provide support to anyone at risk of homelessness, including veterans, there are still housing issues in some parts of the country. In Edinburgh, the number of people living in the city has increased by over 13% in recent years, which has put substantial pressure on housing waiting lists. During the period from 2007, this SNP government invested £558 million in housing grant support in Edinburgh, which contributed to the completion of more than 13,000 affordable homes. Over the 5 years from 2021, Edinburgh will further benefit from the Affordable Housing Supply Programme investment of £234 million towards the delivery of even more good quality affordable homes, which is an increase of £32 million or 16% on the previous 5 years. Despite this, The growth of the Edinburgh population is such that we need to make use of all suitable housing to help meet the demand. The MOD, as a landlord, owns hundreds of empty service family accommodation in Edinburgh and Lothian. I've been highlighting this issue over many years with all those individuals who have held the Westminster Defence Minister brief. Thankfully, the MOD have at long last agreed to sell some of those empty properties to Edinburgh Council, starting with an initial batch of 23 out of the 78 empty homes that have lain empty over many years in the Dreadcorn estate. Presiding Officer, hopefully it won't be long before the other 900 empty MOD homes across Scotland will also become available to, I'm just finishing, sorry, to those 600 homeless veterans and others who require a home. This will go some way in removing one of the barriers facing Army personnel in their transition to civilian life and employment in Scotland.
Thank you, Mr MacDonald. We now move to the final speaker in the open debate, after which we'll move to closing speeches, and I would expect every member who has participated in the debate to be here for the start of those closing speeches. With that, I call Maggie Chapman again for a generous 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I begin, can I apologise to you, the Cabinet Secretary, and others in the Chamber for arriving late to this debate this afternoon. I mean no disrespect. I would like to thank Keith Brown for the engagement we've had on this important motion. It matters, as others have already highlighted today, because it acknowledges some major challenges that we perhaps do not often recognise or discuss. Research has shown that working-age veterans are twice as likely as non-veterans to be unemployed, and that many discover a lack, real or perceived, of transferable skills when they come to seek civilian employment. Difficulties in both mental and physical health, housing problems, as we've heard from the previous speaker and others, inadequate transition planning by the armed forces, family issues including schools and relationship breakdown, financial problems, and unhelpful public attitudes can all build barriers to successful integration into civilian work. We celebrate the many ways in which the needs of veterans and their families are being recognised and addressed, including in specific work by GP practices, schools, Social Security Scotland, and in the Armed Services Advice Project. That work, along with the partnerships outlined in the motion, will be essential to their continuing and enhanced well-being. Some of the challenges experienced by veterans arise directly and entirely understandably from their deployment in combat or conflict zones. Harmful levels of drinking, violent behaviour, anxiety and depression, as well as PTSD, are all natural and understandable responses to the horrors of war and its aftermath. And the deployment of special forces means that the UK soldiers are involved in more conflict than we might imagine. But there are also aspects of military culture that, even here in the UK, in our relative peace, are deeply problematic. Bullying, racism, sexual assault and harassment must be addressed within the armed forces as assiduously as within any other workplace. In fact, especially so given the lack of employment rights or union representation. Many people experience fulfilling careers within the armed forces and would recommend the life to others. But there are others for whom the promise held out by contemporary consumer-led military recruitment of adventure, social mobility, self-fulfillment, and camaraderie brings bitter fruit. Those for whom military life is most damaging are, overwhelmingly, the very young and those who come from backgrounds of poverty and trauma, signed up to serve in the army infantry, the most dangerous of roles. In an era of recruitment shortfalls, those are the very young people who are being targeted by increasingly commercial advertising campaigns in both traditional and social media. In 2021 to 2022, 30% of new recruits to the British Army were aged under 18, and more soldiers were enlisted at 16 than at any other age. The UK is the only country in Europe, the only NATO member, and the only permanent member of the UN Security Council routinely to accept 16-year-old recruits. This policy has been condemned by children's commissioners in all four nations. Yes.
Edward Mountain.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank the member for giving way on that point. I think we need to be very careful when we talk about young people joining the armed services. Whilst they can join the armed services, and go through the training before 18. They cannot take part in active service till 18 or bear arms. I wonder if the member would care to acknowledge that fact.
Maggie Chapman, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Edwin Mountain for that intervention. Yes, I do acknowledge that, but some of the other issues that I've already spoken about and the surrounding impacts mean that some of these 16-year-olds are the most vulnerable and therefore most likely to have adverse experiences when they leave the Army, as I'm going to come on to talk about. This policy has been condemned by children's commissioners in all four nations, by human rights and faith organisations, and by veterans themselves. Those 16-year-olds are likely to experience the worst outcomes throughout their time in the Army, and the evidence on this is clear. Many leave before they are 18 and find themselves both out of work and out of education. Most disadvantaged young people now stay on at school or college after 16, but those who leave with a plan of joining the Army rarely return to the education they left. If they remain as soldiers, it will probably be in the infantry, with a higher likelihood than any other part of the Army of casualty, mental or physical, or of death. The younger they are, the more adverse childhood experiences they have already experienced, and the earlier they leave, the more likely the experience of initial training, with its intense stresses, including isolation and exhaustion, its stimulation of aggression, and its harsh discipline, is to create or exacerbate long-term mental ill health. Those teenagers, disappointed, disillusioned, perhaps deeply damaged, who have left the Army are as much veterans as the older men who fought in the Falklands or the Second World War. Their plight is often invisible, but our responsibility towards them is no less for that reason. It is a responsibility to support them in every way possible, but also to ask how we can protect other vulnerable young people from becoming early veterans. In 2018, this Parliament's Public Petitions Committee reported on armed forces visits to schools, on how recruitment is not just an event, but a process, and made recommendations about guidance, scrutiny, and data. At a time when war is in all of our thoughts, and military spending and prestige are increasing, this is an issue which we might do well to revisit, conscious of how positive campaigns, such as support for girls in STEM education, can be used as a wedge to normalise the presence and influence of the military. I commend the work of those who raise awareness of issues about the armed forces, especially in relation to young people, including the provision of information about their obligations and rights. And I would like to put on record, as others have this afternoon, my thanks to those organisations and employers who seek to support veterans of whatever age and their families, not only into employment, but with all the other aspects of living a civilian life that come fraught with difficulties and challenges to those who have experienced horrors most of us are grateful not to have had to endure. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, members of this Parliament and the people we represent will hold a wide range of views about war, about the armed forces and the role of the military in Scotland's future. But we can share a recognition that those who have joined and left the armed forces after a long or a short period deserve our most serious care and attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Champman. I would just have a gentle reminder to members to have their mobile devices on silent mode. We now move to the closing speeches. I call Martin Whitfield for a generous 7 minutes or so.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it has been both a fascinating, interesting, and I would suggest very respectful debate this afternoon. And a number of members have pointed out that across this chamber, we extend our thanks to our armed services, both past and present, for what they do. And we've had a fascinating insight, both into the often less seen work of the armed forces, but also examples of veterans and third sector and companies that are guiding that transition out of the armed forces and into civilian life. Scottish Labour are very clear that we require statutory targets to underpin the delivery of the Armed Forces Covenant. Many have spoken about the Covenant this afternoon, and it should be the very base of expectation that those who serve in our armed forces, be it half a day, be it many decades, should expect from the communities when they are welcomed back into them. I would also say that Scottish Labour recognised the challenges in particular that armed forces children and young people face, and that their opinion should be listened to and taken seriously in all matters that affect them. And I'll return to that, if I may, later on in my speech. But I would like to highlight my colleague Paul Sweeney's opening contribution on behalf of Scottish Labour, in particularly making reference to the event that happened this week with Glasgow's Helping Heroes, also mentioned by my colleague Carol Mockin. And I think, along with some fascinating and incredibly insightful videos and a very worthwhile report enabling our armed forces community to thrive, the phrase that caught me was that those who were brave enough to join up need to be brave enough to push open the door and go into a supportive, holistic group of people that understand the challenges that they've faced and get a single one-shop support for all that they need in Glasgow. And I extend my thanks to all of those involved in that, including the Forces in Mind Trust, who I know funded it. And I think it speaks to a number of contributions this afternoon about the very great variety of veterans that we now have in our communities, from those who are young and have left because the life of the armed forces was not what they expected, as Maggie Chapman has pointed out, and the challenges that they face, all the way through to perhaps, as Jamie Green emphasised, the more classic view of a veteran that people have in their mind. But all of them deserve the support both of this chamber and in Scotland for what they have done. I want to raise the point of those that suffer both physical and mental trauma as a result of their time in service and the very particular aspects and challenges that they face. And I think it's been recognised by a lot of speakers about that, particularly Graham Day, and it's always worth listening to someone with his expertise and knowledge about this subject, of which he speaks passionately, about the 2,000 individuals here in Scotland that it accounts to.
Graham Day.
Thank you for your kind words. On the subject of veterans who've been left damaged in some way and have suffered through their time in the services, would he join me in recognising that cohort of gay and transgender people who are represented now by Fighting With Pride, I know the Cabinet Secretary is well versed on, but who up until 1995 was the last person to be jailed merely for being homosexual in the army as it was portrayed at the time. And I wonder if he would join me in recognising that cohort and our responsibility to put right what they suffered now insofar as we can.
Martin Whitfield.
Absolutely, and I'm very grateful for that intervention. Our armed forces reflect our wider society exactly as our wider society is, and the support that we extend to any minority group should also be extended to the equivalent minority group within our armed forces. And I'm actually minded of the situation, not in Scotland, but that I know a significant number of veterans will be aware of following the death of Peter Brown, the veteran flight sergeant who was from the Windrush generation, who died on his own, and the call has gone out to find family members and those that recall him, those that support him, to attend his funeral. And I think it is, you know, speaks to a position that we would never want to find ourselves in, but also speaks to a position of reality, what some veterans today are facing. I would like to speak about Christine Graham's contribution because I found it firstly incredibly powerful. That simple statement that one size does not fit all of our veterans is so important in any aspect of interaction. The lack of proper data that we need, and also the very powerful discussion that both Christine Graham and others, including Jamie Green, made about the spouses and partners of our veterans and our young people. We are still incredibly short of data on our armed forces children.
Will. Edward Mountain.
I thank the member for giving way on that point. Many of our veterans' families are not able to be compensated and looked after by schemes that are set up by governments because they are not veterans themselves. Would the member also just take a moment to congratulate those associations within regiments and units who take specific pride in raising money for families to assist them where the government can't?
Martin Whitfield, again, I can give you the time back.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I have no challenge whatsoever in extending my thanks and gratitude to all organisations, to all groups. And I think it speaks very much of what we've also heard today about the comradeship that is sometimes lost when people leave the armed forces, that is such a strong part of our armed forces. I would like to take a short opportunity, though, to mention Forces Children Scotland, which is an incredibly important organisation that supports veteran families in those transitions between schools that we've heard about, in that explanation that our young people have to give to their friends in school about what being an armed services child is like, the fear and concern that they have of those that are moving and having to make new circles of friends, but also those who stay in one place where one parent is away on service, and to make mention of the Forces Life Board game and comic book that Forces Children created in trying to help to explain to their friends what their experiences are like being a Forces child. For decades, this group have worked to advocate and support children and young people, to try and persuade our local authorities to have Forces champions to reach out to them. The children and young people in Forces and veteran families have experiences unique from those of most of us. The anxiety of the parent away on active duty, the difficulty of relocating regularly, the challenge that that brings in their education, and of course the challenge that that brings in the social support that those families need, and also those who are young carers, and the responsibilities that they feel are placed on their shoulders about younger siblings, brothers and sisters, and the impact that that has on their future opportunities and employability. In conclusion, I think this has been a very positive debate and it's been glad to have. It's one that we rightly should have regularly to keep an eye on the Scottish Government's commitments that are made, those that are both statutory, those that they rightly take on behalf of the people of Scotland. But it is also an opportunity for those people in our armed forces, the veterans, and in the case that I make, their families and children, to know we are thinking of them, they are important, and they will remain centrefold of decisions that we make here. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whitfield. I now call on Alexander Stewart. Again, a generous 7 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased and delighted to be able to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives and speak in support of the amendment in the name of Edward Mountain. I welcome that time has been set aside to debate how best we can support veterans as they transition into civilian life. It is right that we also acknowledge the important role that veterans' families can and do play throughout the process and how they support them with this. We owe our veterans a debt of sincere gratitude, Presiding Officer, for their service to our country. I know that many across the chamber, and we've heard that today, also acknowledge that debt. As well as the gratitude we owe the individuals, our commitment to ensure that we still do all we can in society to support them is vitally important. Veterans are often spoken about as one group. However, Presiding Officer, the truth is that veterans come from various backgrounds, different skill sets, different talents, and different needs. Of course, the common feature amongst the veterans is that they all have something to offer to society when they leave the armed forces. Around 1,800 of those who leave the armed forces each year come to live in Scotland, and it's estimated by 2028 nearly half of veterans will be of working age. It is therefore very important that we acknowledge so much has been done and that we can help them transfer their skills to civilian life as effectively as possible. As the Scottish Veterans Commission has set out the aims of the veterans to transition, it's very important that we always ensure that they get the correct job rather than just any job. It is a common trend amongst this that individuals sometimes feel they sell themselves short when they are trying to find employment or trying to find locations when they leave. And it's vitally important that we ensure that they do not sell themselves short. The support and advice that is offered to service leavers is both vitally important. Careers Transition Partnership, Skills Development Scotland, all of these play their part, but we also have to play our part, Presiding Officer. As it stands, however, a number of veterans and their families are unaware of all the services that are available for them, and that has been acknowledged by the Commissioner. She's talked about that things required to be flagged up so that service leavers can consider all the areas that they're entitled to and the potential careers that they may wish to go into. These include pathways such as self-employment. Many do not see or do not think that self-employment is where they should go, but there's lots of opportunities. And we've heard businesses, big businesses and small businesses, who are happily to support them, and that may give them a stepping stone to setting up their own business. And that's vitally important. It's vitally important that we approach all of these possibilities to ensure that they get that added support, and sometimes added financial support to ensure that can become a reality. It is therefore also important, as I said earlier, that social security is discussed within how systems work. And we know that the benefit take-up strategy, rightly aimed at addressing some of these concerns, covers that area. But the document does acknowledge that veterans are less likely to, as a group, to access all the benefits that they are entitled to. The strategy fails to tailor-make this approach for them, and that has been acknowledged, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will come and speak about that in his summing up this afternoon. It is clear that Scotland has a real role to play in all of this, and it's good to see that the UK Government has been involved with the Scottish Government in trying to work together to manage some of these things. And the reviews that have come forward show very important aspects that take place. But I'd like to mention some of the contributions that we've heard this afternoon, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary himself talked about the maximising the opportunities. That's vitally important, that we maximise the opportunities for each and every service user within this process, and that nobody is forgotten about. Nobody is left behind, I think you said, Cabinet Secretary, in your address. And we talked about general practitioner service, childcare. That's all part of the jigsaw to ensure that they have the support they need. My colleague Edward Mountain talked about the support that armed forces individuals have and the joint strategy that is there. But there are issues when it comes to education, childcare, GP housing and homelessness. And I echo the sentiments that the covenant should be enshrined. These are important that we take on board. Paul Sweeney, and I was at his event this week in Parliament too, and I acknowledge the fantastic support that Help for Heroes are doing in the Glasgow area. And that was a really good eye-opener to show us parliamentarians what is happening on the ground and how we can support. Paul Sweeney also talked about the good practice that takes place in supporting individuals, that individuals from the veterans community can be worth their weight in gold to employers. And that's vitally important, that we get that image across, that they're not individuals who are sitting back, not doing things, or sitting on the street, or have an issue. They are actually opportunities that people can work for and can achieve. My colleague Russell Finlay spoke about the employment issues when it comes to physical and mental veterans who've got these issues to manage, and some do come home with trauma, but many do not come home with any of the traumas that may have been discussed this afternoon. Progress is very important about how we manage the benefits and the isolation and the physical and mental health care of all of these. Jamie Green also talked on about what is required when it comes to healthcare. That's vitally important, but also spoke about, as I saw when I went up to Lossiemouth, where individuals spoke about that the families found it really difficult to find employment, to follow on a job because they had childcaring issues and there wasn't enough support around to make that transition for them. So that's important that we try and marry, and I know the Cabinet Secretary has spoken about it, but that has come. I've been to two or three events over the last Parliament and this Parliament when I've gone to visit forces, and they've talked about that and they continue to talk about that. So there still is a gap there that needs to be looked at. And as I say, homelessness and suicide are also massive issues when it comes to how we manage and support. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, throughout today, and the debate, we've talked about the importance of veterans within our society, about the unique skills set that they bring to these individuals and they offer, and the great potential that they have to ensure that we have a flourishing labour market. We also have heard about some of the specific challenges that veterans still face in transition of living life. And Martin Whitfield spoke about the comic and the board game. And I've had the privilege of being actively involved in that process from its conception, when we had youngsters who came and spoke, and then we went to the university, and the university art class decided to design that process. And I hope that later on in this year, we will have the opportunity here to launch that. It didn't happen because of a delay within ourselves within this building one night when youngsters couldn't come, but I'm sure that will take place in the future. It is clear without question today that there's been a lot of consensus around what's taking place, Presiding Officer, in in this chamber, and we all want to support as many individuals as we can when it comes to the transition. And veterans can enjoy a productive life, and they deserve that because of the contribution they have given and the sacrifices they have paid. We owe it to them to ensure that they get a best start when they leave and join the society that we all enjoy. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I now call on Keith Brown to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary, I'd be grateful if you could take us up to just before decision time, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And just to agree with the last point that was made, I think it has been a very good debate. There's been a substantial degree of consensus, although that wasn't actually my intention in agreeing the debate. If you remember, it was not because anybody asked me to do it, but if you remember the last veterans debate that we had, I said it would be good to have another opportunity out with remembrance when people do feel constrained about criticism or challenge they want to make. That was the purpose behind it. And maybe in future we'll get even more challenge. In future, hopefully, all sides of this chamber will have more attendance at these events, which are about discussing the future of veterans. And perhaps we can attract more people to the public galleries if we can make sure these debates are worthy of that. And I think this nature of the subject, the future of our veterans, I think does merit more interest. It has been generally consensual, and I'm afraid I have to try and reluctantly break that to the extent I can't accept the Labour amendment. If you were to look at the implications, and I've been to Glasgow's Helping Heroes a number of times, I think it's a fantastic organisation. There are many others as well across the country. But the nature of the work that's done by these and other organisations is either through local authorities, or it's through the third sector, or voluntary or charitable bodies. The idea the Scottish Government could insist on taking across the whole country all of where we think there are examples of good practice and putting in a framework or statutory framework, which has been suggested, is not practicable. A great deal of sympathy with the aims behind this, and as I say, every thing I could say about the Glasgow's Helping Heroes project would be positive, and the times I've visited them in the past, but many other projects across the country. We do rely on, in relation to this, around about, I think, 400 charities in Scotland concerned with veterans, and we do rely on local authorities and others to do this. Also, just to say, if I can, to try and soften that blow, if it is a blow, to say that some of the contributions I think we heard from the Labour benches, in particular Carol Mockin, who raised the issue, which is very rarely raised in these debates, about social inequality. Now, if you think about the recruitment grounds for especially infantry, for especially the army, these have been very often in areas of multiple deprivation. I joined the armed forces from an area of multiple deprivation. What I would say, though, is that in the 10 years, or now 13 years, that span the period when I have been doing this job at various points, at the very start, I heard an attitude which was, that's how we found them, we have no responsibility to help them in future. They were happy to say, senior people in the MOD and the armed forces, that's how we find these people and that's how we leave them. We don't have a responsibility. And I think that attitude has changed. I think there is an acknowledgement now, the fact that there is an obligation. If you take somebody at that age in life, and they are then trained in the way they are, they do the things that they do, they make the sacrifices, which Alexander Stewart, then society does have a responsibility. Does the case the armed forces provide education and other opportunities? Yes, I'll take the intervention.
Carol Mochan.
I thank the Minister for his words on that point. It's an important point, as you know, close to my heart about inequalities in society. I just wondered, in terms of supporting the Labour amendment, if you would consider some sort of statement of intent. You know, it's not, we're not asking you to actually, you know, specifically do those things. You know, we're just asking to have some kind of national standard that organisations out there doing work could work to, if you would consider that.
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say to Carol Mockin is that there's been some confusion around. So I've heard from Labour benches the intention, in fact from yourself, I think, to have a statutory framework, statutory standards. I am a bit unclear as to what's proposed, as to whether that's something that you think that the Scottish Parliament should agree, or whether it's something that's going to be imposed or brought in by a potential future UK government. I know the Conservatives, for example, say they want to, just if I can just finish this point, they want to bring forward a bill. I'm happy to look at that bill when it's brought forward. I'm happy to look at any proposals the Labour Party have in relation to this as well, but it's not yet clear to me exactly what's intended and how you intend to go beyond the cover governance provisions, which are obviously enshrined in law, only as far as saying that statutory services have got to take into account the interests of veterans. So I'm not sure exactly what's proposed, but perhaps we can find out just now from Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving way. It is disappointing that the Government has minded not to support the amendment. I can perhaps offer some reassurance to the Minister, though, that we're not proposing that this is put as a sort of universal statutory straitjacket on government to dictate how local services should be designed. What it is about is advertising or creating national exemplars which can offer inspiration to local authorities when designing services that are appropriate to their area. So perhaps in that spirit you might consider supporting the amendment even at this late stage.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, unfortunately, I do have to consider the amendments on the order paper in front of me. What I would say, though, in trying to respond to the point that Paul Sweeney and Carol Mockin have made, is that we currently do try and do that through, for example, the Veterans Fund. We'll try and make sure we contribute to areas of good practice. And I'm willing to continue that discussion about how we can go forward in that area. So, I think it's well-intentioned. I just think the practical implications are perhaps not the ones which were sought when the amendment was drawn up, and for that reason, can't support it. I can support the Conservative motion, and I've said that I would do that. And I would just try and just say a couple of points about the discussion we've had about the relationship between the UK Government and the Scottish Government in relation to this. And just to give more flesh, I would exempt from anything I'm about to say Annabel Goldie, who I think has been somebody that's always been keen to work together collegiately. Although, just to say, to exemplify the point I'm about to make, the last time I asked to meet with her, went to meet with her in London, the door of the MOD was essentially shut in my face. They wouldn't even recognise the ID card that I had. They had no knowledge of the meeting. Now, that is an example of the attitude I've had from the Secretary of State, who's continuously refused to meet with me, unlike previous Secretaries of State. We've had one meeting of the Ministerial Veterans Group over the last 2 years. In relation to the recent innovation of the Scottish Government to pay for the medals, the cost of the medals of veterans who have legitimately lost or had them stolen, again, I was assured of a response. I've had no response. And I take at face value Jamie Green's offer and any other Conservative's offer to say this attitude could change for the reasons that many Conservatives have said. If we work together on these things, we can achieve more. That has not been my experience. And another example of that would be the LIBOR funding, because much has been said about some of the very good initiatives by the UK Government. But the UK Government withdrew the LIBOR funding overnight, and the Scottish Government, with no dedicated resources coming to it from the UK Government for veterans funding, has had to find funding to backfill some, for example, Age Scotland recently, who was previously funded by the LIBOR funding. So there is scope for a lot greater work. There is more that we can achieve together. Can I just say to Maggie Chapman, I'm very appreciative of both the remarks that she made initially and also the fact of the relationship that we've had working on these and justice issues, which has been very productive, very respectful until today when she referred to the old men that served in the Falklands War. So that's it. The relationship between her and I is over after that. So I think there has been, though, some very good contributions made, and I think I would hope that in time, whoever is responding for the government in relation to these things, that we can build on today, because it's been a bit tentative, if we're honest. People have tried to be consensual, which is good, but there are challenges to be made to the government, there's challenges to be made elsewhere, and the more that we can do that, the more we can improve the service that we all provide to veterans. I've tried to respond to the point raised by Christine Graham, which was very much around spouses and families of serving personnel, and the point that we both made about how that's very crucial to the morale of serving personnel. And she asked a question about what we do for them when transition happens. Well, I think the point I was trying to make in my initial remarks was that we should be doing it long before transition happens. Because if we can make sure that spouses of serving personnel, if they're nurses, teachers, doctors, if they're properly employed during the time that their spouse or partner is in service, then of course that transition becomes much easier. So we have to tackle it at the earliest possible stage. And like others, I think there's been, certainly I'll give away to Martin Whitfield.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Keith Brown giving way. Could he comment about the paucity of data with regard to Forces children, and also possibly comment on the census publication with regard to the question contained?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I would say I was very interested in the point that was made. My constituency is the only one in Scotland with a school dedicated to the children of Armed Forces personnel, so I'm very close to this issue with the Queen Victoria School in Dunblane. Just to answer the point, and Paul Sweeney asked the question in his initial remarks, 2024, next year is when we'll have the data from the census. But in the meantime, we have worked with the UK government on the survey, which asks the questions, some of which will relate to children, but more generally about people's experience in the armed forces. And we have still to work through the kind of treasure trove of information that that will provide. But he raised a very important point. And just to underline the point that he made, I'm well aware in the time that I've been doing this job of one unit that was moved from Germany to Edinburgh, to Northern Ireland within 18 months. And the children had to move, go into three different educational systems, and that is not good for anybody. The point was made, I think, by Maggie Chapman about the way you treat people in the armed forces, and especially given the fact that they have families. So I think there's been a great deal of very valuable contributions in the debate. I would hope this would be the first of our future debates that we have in relation to veterans and how they can best be ensured of our support. In this case, we're talking about employability. The same would be true in terms of homelessness, and the same would be true in terms of their health. And just to repeat, finally, and in conclusion, Presiding Officer, and I'm not making a point against anybody, but there is a temptation, there has been for many years, to try and portray veterans, and again, I use that horrendous phrase, as being mad, bad and sad. And that is so far removed from the vast majority of veterans who do manage to come straight back into society, are productive. We've all said on all sides of the chamber how much they can offer employers, how much they can offer society. So it does not reflect them. They are not overrepresented in terms of homelessness. They are not overrepresented in terms of mental health issues. They are not overrepresented in terms of the prison population either, although there are some very interesting and challenging aspects to the veteran prison population in Scotland, which Forces in Mind, to be mentioned, will look at, especially in relation to sexual offending. But the vast majority of veterans come back into society, play a very productive role. And our challenge collectively is to make sure that that role is commensurate with what they've done. As I said at the start, if you come out as a colour sergeant, having spent 30 years in the armed forces, with all that experience, all that training, and then you're asked to feel grateful because you get a job which is way below that level of experience, then that is not doing right by veterans. We have to do better by veterans. I am keen to continue working with the UK government. I'm grateful for the offer of Jamie Green to see what we can do to improve relations there. And just to conclude by saying that we published a refreshed Veterans Strategy Action Plan where we made several commitments under the employment, education and skills theme. As I've said to members, we will follow that through. But it's right that we are challenged in future, and I would hope that whoever's responsible for this area in terms of the government, that we continue to do that, and let's have more debates, and let's have more people coming to the debates from all parties in this House, because there was not enough people here to hear some of the very good speeches that were made. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate on employment support for veterans and their families. It is now time to move on to the next item of business. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 8332.1 in the name of Edward Mountain, which seeks to amend Motion 8332 in the name of Keith Brown, on employment support for veterans and their families, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that Amendment 8332.2, in the name of Paul Sweeney, which seeks to amend Motion 8332 in the name of Keith Brown, on employment support for veterans and their families, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow access to digital voting.